concentration of endophytic bacteria in organic fertilizer site found to be more, followed by no fertilizer, and the least well recorded in inorganic fertilizer sites of maize. Before concluding remarks, let me focus on a million-dollar question: do we really need endophytes? This is a piece of work procured from Kumar and co-workers, and they have got a wonderful results with the endophytes, where they have characterized the bacterial endophytes for plant growth promoting traits and the antibacterial and the antifungal activity of these endophytic strains of turmeric. One among them is the Chattobacterium michiganensis, which is reported to be a pathogen of tomato canker. Endophytes can be considered as a disarmed pathogen, thus lost their functional type 3 secretion systems. These may again have a pathogenic effect in the course of evolution, so we have to be very careful before getting attracted to any new research. This is the representation of a possible plant-microbe interactions favoring a plant growth or a biocontrol of the phytopathogens by endophytes, where a plant growth promotion is employed through the either nitrogen fixation, uptake of nutrients and other carbon sources, or the peak solubilization, and the abiotic stress management is maybe by production of a proline and the sugars, volatile compounds, glycine, butane, and production of phytohormones, and the biocontrol agent, biotic stress can be controlled by lytic enzyme production, so the toxins, antibiotics, and finally by the induced systemic resistance. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Okay, thank you, Rachana, for your presentation. I think we have focused right from isolation of the endophyte and up to metagenomics and whole genome sequencing of the endophytes. Both issues, where you are covering about the fungal endophytes and the bacterial endophytes and their mechanism of action, which has been already published, and the published papers has been presented by you. And I think now it is open for the discussion. And before, I would like to put some questions to you. So can you please say me what are the MAP molecules of bacterial endophyte origin, which are found to be associated with the defense mechanism? So because you are talking about the MAP molecule, right? Microbe associated molecular pattern based molecules. So what are the MAP molecules which are associated with the bacterial endophytes, which in turn communicate to the plant to induce the resistance response? Rachana, are you available? Rachana, can you hear me? I don't know what happened.
Sir, it seems she has left the meeting.
Okay. So, Nakira, this is Prasanna Kumar here.
Okay.
So, just would like to extend that particular question to me. So, I would like to see there are so many factors that are present in the endophytic organisms as well as in the pathogenic. So, these are some of the factors that are there, which are delivered, and these are the ones which are able to modulate the MAP system. So there are specific effectors that are present in each of the bacteria in the form of a type 3 effector system, and a very recent study that has been found is the type 4 system has a role to play in modulating the resistance in the plants.
Okay, Dr. Prasanna Kumar, I think you are trying to complement the question which was raised. I'll still be specific. There are plenty of MAP molecules are found to be associated, where we have published recently some 2 or 3 papers related to MAP-triggered immunity against viral disease management, published in Frontiers and all other things. So I think that a better understanding on MAP molecule and pattern mechanism in the chart.
Sir?
Yes. Yes, please.
He's currently with you, try.
Rachana?
Sir, this is Sun.
Yeah, please.
So there was some disturbance with the Wi-Fi. No. Sorry for the.
No problem.
Sir. Yeah, sir. Sir, can you please repeat your question?
So can you please explain what is the role of what are the MAP molecules that are associated with the bacterial endophytes and can in turn communicate with the client with the pattern recognition receptors to trigger the immune response?
Sir, either the lipopolysaccharides or the flagellin of the bacteria, those are act as the MAPs, which interact with the receptors and helps in the triggering the
bacteria. Okay, then when it goes and deals with the various other pathways, which is meeting calling with them, I think in my explanations and my presentations, I will touch some of those points. And thank you for your presentation. If someone would like to ask some questions, I think they can come for discussion.
So thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Ranjana.
Thank you very much, sir, for your wonderful presentation.
And if there is no more questions, can we go for the next question?
I would like to request the organizing secretary, Dr. N.K. Bharat, to please felicitate Dr. Archana by presenting her
diesel. हाँ मनोज अभी पहुंचा
थैंक यू सर
मना कर दिया कि अभी नहीं
थैंक यू
मैंने यहाँ बोल दिया रूपलाल
सो द नेक्स्ट प्लेस लीड स्पीकर वी हैव चेयरमैन सर ओनली डॉक्टर एस नकिरन He will be speaking on the topic harnessing the potential of microbial consortia in well strategies for sustainable plant health management. Dr. Nakiran, please you may start your presentation, sir.
मनोज जी अभी मत डालना इसको ना ऑटो पे अभी मत डालो अभी प्रेजेंटेशन चल रही है फिर हम आपको बता दें
20 के बाद करना
हम आपको बता दें ठीक है ना फिर ऑटो पे डाल दें मतलब इसी पे डाल देना जेन सेक्टर अभी मत
सो कैन यू प्लीज सी दिस स्लाइड्स
नो नो बोल दो नहीं बोल रहा
क्या
आरती कैन यू प्लीज सी द स्लाइड
नो मैं बोल रहा नहीं यार यही है वो अभी जब तक
No, sir. It's not visible, sir. Your presentation is... No, sir.
बता दो इनको जैसे जैसे तो जानकारी
Sir, have you opened your presentation?
Yeah, I opened my presentation.
You minimize it on desktop and then click on the this present now link. Okay, now it's coming, sir.
Admit करो पहले.
नहीं अभी नहीं आई.
Can you see my slide,
please? Yes, sir. Yeah, it's coming, sir.
Okay.
You may start.
So, on behalf of the organizers and Dr. Gautam, I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me this great opportunity to share because the harnessing the potential microbial consortia, since the topic is going to be very wide, I have concised the title in relation to harnessing the Trichoderma consortia mediated induction of resistance on the management of fungal limited complex of Cucumber and protected cultivation. So I'd like to share the work which has been carried out from my lab. So here the smart agriculture, though it is the need of the day, on the other side we can see there is a big increase. But what is the status of pesticide consumption and what is the status of resistant development and the disease outbreak? And if so, what are they? So these are the questions which are going to be present in front of us. So under protected cultivation, the area is going on gaining momentum both in every places where the monoculture has resulted in the expression of or increase in the expression of the fungal limited complex, which has been augmented to around process 70% yield loss and 10 to 50% yield reduction. So this is the case where the protected cultivation will be fungal limited complex. So this is the fissure of wilt and the root knot limited melanogen infiltrator is going to be causing the infection here. So if so, how to address this fungal limited complex? So this is the question which is going to be present in front of us. So to address this particular issue, the first thing that I would like to ask you is, does Trichoderma has the antifungal activity in the plant? So for that, the various Trichoderma species that we have isolated from the plant system, as an endophyte we have collected, and then the Trichoderma harshianum, Violex, Aspergillum, Conidiopsis, Aspergillus has been isolated and has been submitted against the database also. And here, We would like to assess what is the efficacy of an individual organism and how best all put together, both the effective organisms, if they are put together, what's the synergy of their expression of their action. So all those things are going to be investigating in this one presentation here. And this particular representation of the slide explains the antifungal action through viral culture. So here the Trichoderma virus. So this completely hyperparasitized the Fusarium accessorum, Fusarium accessorum putamenum. And the Trichoderma coningens is also hyperparasitized the Fusarium over here. So what's the major advantage we are interested here is when there is an interaction is found to be taking place through hyperparasitism on the pathogen. So what is the change in the composition of the volatile organic compound and non-volatile organic compound produced by this particular fungal antagonist? That is one of the major questions here. So here this is the Trichoderma coningensis where we can see the hyperparasitism here. So when it is going for the hyperparasitism, in the presence of the pathogen, the volatile Q that has been produced is going to be totally different compared to the volatile Q produced by the Trichoderma when it is going to be grown under monotrophic interaction. When it is grown under the dietrophic interaction, the metabolite production is going to be totally different. So that is the one we would like to highlight here. And here if you see, the in vitro screening, right, the Trichoderma virus, if you take the Trichoderma virus, the growth of the pathogen is around 2.98 cm, but the percent in EV is now 66.89, plus Trichoderma ascarella, it has a 62% inhibition, 65% inhibition with Trichoderma coningens. So based on our preliminary screening, so these three species were found to be effective in suppression and it is taken to the hyperparasitism. It took only 2.7 days and 3.4 and 2.9 days for the hyperparasitism as against the gastrin, which was another one to notice. Whereas here, the Trichoderma coningens, so this is the area of our interest. So here, what are the profile of the volatile molecule or the volatile organic compound and non-volatile organic compound? So as discussed earlier, the percent inhibition is going to be expressed more with respect to Trichoderma coningensis, Trichoderma virus, and Trichoderma ascarella. So this is the electron microscopic photograph which clearly explains over here, the scanning electron microscope, how the Trichoderma, coningensis TRF41, where it hyperparasitized the pathogen, where it's a high particular of the Fusarium accessorum from there is a cucumerida. And B is the healthy hyphae of the Trichoderma coningensis, and here in this figure, the C is the one we can see, and D are the one which is going to be completely hyperparasitized by Trichoderma on Fusarium. So if it is hyperparasitism, is there any variation in non-volatile organic compound profile zone of interaction? So this is the issue which we have raised here. So here, when you go for the GCMS analysis of the metabolite which has been extracted from the zone of interaction, so the metabolite that has been dissipated into the medium, so that has been extracted and that has been subjected for the GCMS analysis. So the GCMS analysis which indicates here that the compounds such as formic acid 2, propylene ester, then pentyl ethylene, glycol, then benzyl, dimethyl, then pentadiol-H, EM, hexa, ethylic acid. So these four different compounds, so they are found to be compounds. From the non-hyperparasitized region. Whereas in the case of the non-hyperparasitized region, so we can see the presence of alanine, beta, naphthyl, amide. So this is the compound which has been produced in the non-hyperparasitized region over this place. So this is the area where it is non-hyperparasitized has been taken place. And this is the heptacosan 2 cyclo there is a heptacosanone. So these are the two different compounds which has been produced in the non-hyperparasitic zone. So likewise, in the area sunlight also, if you see these two compounds are found to be here also common in the case of the from the hyperparasitic region. So this is the common molecule which is found to be produced both to the hyperparasitism and during the absence of the hyperparasitism, apart from that of the four unique molecules which has been produced in the organisms. And next, the non-volatile organic compound from the pathogen. So the pathogen also produces compound, and those compounds are also formic acid to propylene ester. So this formic acid is also produced by your hypoglycemia, maybe the Trichoderma coningensis. And likewise, there's a penta, ethylene glycol, and benzyl, and dimethyl penta, diol, and hexadecoic acid. So these are the four different molecules produced by the pathogen alone. So here, what I'd like to emphasize here is during the interaction how people along with the hyperparasitic go for co-cultivation, sort of interact with the nitrophic nature, the metabolic profile is going to be totally different. If it's the case, does trichoderma species, in addition to the antibiotic, does it have antigenic action against the root fundamental? So this is the question that we would like to answer. So this is the root fundamental melanogenic network data, which has been cultured, and this is the one where the egg was determining to release the flies, and the danger flies. And the melanogenic network data has been molecularly confirmed using this species, temporary desert control, where the flies have been identified as melanogenic network data, and the female also identified as melanogenic network data over here. So to understand what is the antigenic property of this particular trichoderma, 23 of this trichoderma virus and trichoderma sporula, the number of gonads, if gonads, the experts for the trichoderma species, what is the strain which is supposed to do, the number of gonads, plus the half-per-cent of the egg. So all these parameters have been taken into consideration. In the case of the number of gonads hatched out from the untreated control, 172 50 gonads has come out from the egg. Whereas in the case of the treatment with respect to trichoderma coli, trichoderma virus, and trichoderma sporula, the incubation rate from the disease, the number of gonads was 49 and 61 gonads has been released. So in this particular case, the inhibition of the gonadal release is going to be low. So this is also exploiting a particular trichoderma species for your suspension is also going to be playing a vital role in inhibiting the fly mobility and the hatching of the flies. So this is a microscopic photograph which explains that the complete ramification of the egg mass, the hyperparasitism of the root fundamental of the egg mass by trichoderma coli, theory, what you have been noticed here, where the complete colonization has been noticed, and subsequently we see here the trichoderma colonizes the root fundamental of the egg mass. So these are the colonies where we can see the presence of the conidia along with that of the hybrid is going to be growing the egg mass. So this is the beautiful photograph which explains how the conidia is going to be hyperparasitized in the egg mass and how it penetrates and how it is the lysis of the egg mass. This is the one map, this is the untreated control where the egg mass is going to be without any colonization. This is the case there. The root mass, that is the eggs, and it is exposed to the conidia right up and down. It does this colonization ramification, thus results in the suppression of the survival rate and the day to release of the gonads from the top of the egg mass. And the next one, do trichoderma trigger the immune response is the next question. So to understand whether this trichoderma mediates any immune response, this eight different treatments has been considered to understand whether they are triggering. So to understand the different mechanism induced to the root nematode resistance induced by trichoderma coliangiensis, we have investigated the presence of the defense gene expression on female acrylic acid T-carboxylase, which was used to regulate the synthesis and activity of CA and mitochondrial activated protein kinase with phosphorylation and pathogenic immunity. Here one, rather is the latent one, which is found to be regulating the systemic acquired resistance, the RIG-T33D transcription factor. So this is to regulate the signaling and transcriptional reprogramming of the FLAN defense. And the main transcription factor regulating the jasmonic acid, the catalyst creates in the regulation of the reactive oxygen species in defense. And PAL gene has been tested, which is associated with the salicylic acid biosynthesis. And lipoxygene is associated with the jasmonic acid biosynthesis. And JAR1 is also found to be associated with the JAS synthesis. And ISR and SIS is going to be coordinated with the NPR1, so the one is the level of expression of the NPR1. And besides, the MIG transcription factor, which is going to be associated with jasmonic acid signaling pathway, is also going to be assessed to understand whether the nematocytal activity against the root fundamental and the fungal impact by disease the PCR analysis has been done using the different treatments. So this is the G1 is the healthy control, and P there is a G3 is the healthy control which has been supplemented with the WHO inoculated with the trichoderma virus. Whereas in the case of the P7 and T8, we are combining the two on trichoderma virus and trichoderma coliangiensis alone. And what is the level of expression of the transcript in the presence of trichoderma virus, trichoderma coliangiensis along with the Fusarium oxysporum put Marina and along with another group Patna Metro. So this is the point. So in the presence of the serial access control, put Marina and the group Patna Metro, rather than the impact data, the expression of the repeat 33 transcription factor is found to be several fold increase up to 1.5 fold and up to 2 fold increase as we noticed in the case of the challenge inoculation by the pathogen in the presence of the pathogen and in the presence of the group Patna Metro. Whereas in the case of the healthy control, initially there was a down regulation of this particular transcription factor as possible. But if you see the co-associated functional proteins with that of the associated with that of RIKIT33 transcription factor, so here's the RIKIT33 transcription factor. So this RIKIT33 transcription factor regulates these different genes also. So as the RIKIT transcription factor, not only it's getting activated, but it goes and triggers the uncharacterized protein. It triggers the protein transmitter stuck glabra, then leukoanthocyanidin deoxygenase, then dihydroflavonoid co-reductase, homeomoxolusin citric protein glabra 2, anthocyanidin reductase, and W2 repeat containing protein LWD1, and KBC transporter, which is one of the responsible for the transport of most of the enzymes, which is one of the going on over there. So if you see here, this uncharacterized protein which has been triggered by this repeat transcription factor. But this not only goes and triggers in pain reaction, this uncharacterized protein goes and triggers protein phospholipase. So here this goes and triggers the uncharacterized protein and this uncharacterized protein triggers the other one. So likewise a cyclic reaction is going on taking place by the same finger protein, biochim synthase, fugitive chain, and titan elicitor binding protein, taxosteroid incense tool associated with separate kinds of fugitive, actin related protein, then pentatricopeptide repeat containing, and binding of this with the of the brassinosteroids insensitive one is also contributing this. And this particular binding of BA, what results is, it helps in growth promoting hormones expression and phosphorylation towards the growth and photosynthesis. So this is the explanation where when we go for the application of this particular one, it goes and triggers the RIKIT33 transcription factor, which in turn not only triggers the resistance response, that it also goes and regulates the growth promoting hormones, phosphorylation, where it helps in mobilization of the available phosphorus is going to be present in that of the soil, which results in growth and photosynthesis. And next, it also results in the induction of MYC transcription factor mediated by trichotillomycin spondylometric complex in cucumber. Where here also, if you see the MYC is another essential transcription factor which is found to be associated in coordinating with the resistance response. Then here, if you see, compared to that of the healthy control, case of the one which has been challenged with the economy, trichotillomycin, there is a vesicular access from cucumberinum, only melanogen inculcate in the presence of virus and in the presence of trichotillomycin, as a collective organism, so there's a synergy in the expression of the transcription factor. So the expression of this particular MYC transcription factor, the associated functional proteins which has been associated with this MYC transcription factors are one. This also triggers uncharacterized protein. It goes and activates the protein transfrontal stem glabra, leukoanthocyanidin deoxygenase, then dihydroflavonoid 4 reductase, homeomoxolusin protein, anthocyanidin reductase, WB repeat containing protein, ABC transporter is once again here. This MYC transcription factor also triggers this, and fugitive uncharacterized protein and fugitive characteristic protein has been also induced by the activation of the MYC transcription factor. So like that, you are also interested to understand what is the role of MYC transcription factor. So the MYC transcription factor here also, there's an increase in the expression of the transcript level compared to that of the down-regulated expression in the case of the healthy control. So this MYC transcription factor followed by lipoxygenase. So this is the key enzyme which is found to be associated with the induced systemic resistance to trigger the cascade events happening among related to the jasmonic acid response to one jasmonic acid and followed by NPR1 regulation, and all those things are found to be coordinated with this particular lipoxygenase gene, where the expression never is found to be more, but it is found to be challenged with the pathogen and with the nematode in the presence of the trichotillomavirus and trichotillomaconitiasis. Beyond how to explain that this type of genesis is also found to be playing a vital role in index of resistance response. So this rise to life of genesis, the transcript level of NPR1 was also found to be expressed theoretically by the application of both trichotillomavirus and trichotillomaconitiasis. Not only that, then NPR1 followed by diazonic acid synthase is also found to be activated in this particular one. Let the PR1 is also found to be coordinated where initially from 0 to 24 hours there is down regulation, but up to 48 to 70 hours it has started getting raised over here. But the down regulation has been observed with respect to the healthy control. So on the need basis only, the induction is found to be taking place in the presence of challenging of the pathogen because of the activated agent. So likewise, a mitochondrial activated protein kinase, which is responsible for the phosphorylation, this is also getting activated. So finally, we would like to conclude that the antifungal and the nematicidal activity is found to be increased due to the expression of all these 10 different transcription factors and the different genes which are found to be associated in the particular study. But besides that, we have also done some of the work on the microbial consortia of the bacterial endophytes. But here from our study, so we have identified the basal sample incubations, the whole genome sequence has been done where basal sample incubations and well senses are found to be very closely related ones. So the amyloid incubations, which has been identified based on the things RNA, after the whole genome sequence is confirmed as basal well senses. And this is the genome size of 4 ME size, and this particular one has a 14 secondary metabolite cluster which has been identified with the whole genome sequencing. Well, this is found to be associated in the production of surfactant, bezilipactin, bezilizin, DPCD, fentanyl, bezidine, macrolactin, calimanchin, heterosin, and pantothiazolizin. Why am I considering this one in places? Because an identification of an organism with the potential biosuperative secondary metabolite production, so those can be incorporated into the system so that we can go for the development of a better consortia with the desirable characters that can increase the broad spectrum of action. So this particular joint application on this combined application of business resistance along with the business performance was also found to be for the suppression of ground and bed necrosis virus infecting tomato. But here, the picture behind this, the application of the equine. So here we have followed the map clones in relation to one of the equine gene and elongation factor. So the agrofactor mediated infectious clones have been elongated to the root zone. So this particular map, when it is infected with the root region, it goes and triggers the mitochondrial protein kinase, which doesn't trigger the entire proteomers. And besides that, it also increases lipoxygenase and gastric acid responsive gene. And as these NPR1 oligomers, they move into the nucleoplasm, and where the NPR1, it is getting activated in presence of the transcription factor and the RIGI and MIG transcription factor. So which in turn coordinates the PR1, PD1.4 and PAL, and this may be complementing for the suppression of the virus. So I, for the summary of the operative work on the ground up necrosis virus, I have presented over here. The other thing we have done, the work will not be covered in 30 minutes. And this is an endo capital by Joe Io, being the resistance of the nitrogen made of paper. Here we have isolated 6 parts of the endophyte on the top of the potato, and this is the endogram which is going to be completely hyperparasitized by the bacteria over here. So this is where we are having a mixture of the bacteria as a consortia. So they colonize and they trigger the expression of the volatile and non-volatile organic compound over here. In addition, they also trigger the difference related RIGI factors and the different genes also like JAR1, NPR1, PAD4 and MIG transcription factor. What I'd like to say here, so which time to release the actual endophytes of the microbiome also can behave as a better stimulator for the induction of resistance response. The next question related to the fundamental context is really any growth promotion mediated by the trichoma. So when you apply this trichoma cholangiosis on the spermosphere, so it colonizes the spermosphere, it produces the mycelium over the sea surface, and it colonizes and produces the foliation. After that, in the case of the root, if we examine the root, the cucumber under the scanning electron microscope, we can see the presence of the trichoderma getting colonized on the root of PTA. So because of this, the root architecture is getting changed over here, where the one that decays trichoderma polyntiasis, the root architecture is going to be totally different, and the volume is also going to be different, which is going to be compensating for the growth promotion. So this is the, in the case of the diversity of non-volatile organic compounds that has been produced in the isoflane. But this particular data indicates that in the presence of the mycelium, the trichoderma polyntiasis is a huge more number of non-volatile organic compounds which is not the complementing for the resistance response at the isoflane region. So in this, how did they formulate and deliver? So this is the general formulation of the effective trichoderma species that this paper has been published last month in Journal of Plant Growth Regulation with an impact factor of 2.8. And this is, has a shelf life up to 180 days. And besides that, the till application and protected cultivation, if a gentleman is proceeding with the soil application of trichoderma, polyngiasis with the trichoderma aspergillum along with the trichoderma aspergillus as a consortia, at the rate of 1 month is being planted the seed and is applied to the seed, so 100 ml per 100,000 meters square and 15-20 days of fruiting. The results aim to increase the vine height, it reduces the fungal matter complex incidence by 13.45 as against 41.32 in the case of the untreated control, and the yield is given to increase to 15 tonnes, whereas it is 10.2 tonnes in the case of the untreated control. So this is the graphical representation of the same, and this pictures, this is the one which has been protected to the field, that is in the protected cultivation. So finally, the means that we have got from this particular experiment or this consortium can be used as an efficient producer of antifungal and antimicrobial metabolites, and these are the potential colonizers of the rhizosphere and stomosphere, and it is a competent producer of the growth hormones such as indolacetic acid and uric acid. It increases the roof architecture and it has a multifarious action and was found to be very, very successful in the field on reducing the nematode complex, fungal nematode complex, and also increase the plant growth. So this is in short about the presentation or the charge that has been given to me. So I thank once again the organizers for giving me this particular opportunity to share my views on the potential of the consortium for the management of the diseases. And now, I think now it is open for the discussion. I think if there is any two states, maybe, but I'm ready to answer your queries, please.
Thank you, Dr. Nitin, for your wonderful presentation. I hope all our audience must have been benefited by your deliberation. So, audience, if you have any question, you may please ask Dr. Nakiran.
Dr. Nakiran?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, thank you very much. Very good insight about these control or microbiomes, which are involved in plant disease management. So, in fact, this Bacillus valenzensis, so that is a wonderful biocontrol, I can say, because it has got a unique cluster of genes, mainly with respect to the antibiosis. In fact, we have also sequenced a couple of Bacillus valenzensis strains, one with 4 MB and the other one 4.2 MB.
Okay.
So, what do you see the diversity in this? Do you have any insights in this?
Yeah, definitely we have several insights, and now what we are doing is we are in the process of patenting the certain information over that whole genome sequencing, and based on certain secondary metabolites we are planning, and the draft has been submitted already. So I think at this position I may not be in a day to disclose several things in that still the patent get approved.
Okay. So that is really
But what is the thing is, there are number of secondary metabolites are there, which none of them has touched those things. So those metabolites we can concentrate more, and those metabolites can be formulated and it can be taken to a greater extent for the management of several diseases. And in that particular eye only now we have submitted the draft for patenting those things. So this is the broad view that I can say. For example, the lanthipeptides. No one has started doing any work on lanthipeptide, which is also having a greater opportunity for the exploring it for the antifungal action. And sometimes they are also having antibacterial activity. And if you see the global perspective of the availability of the antibacterial compounds, only very few compounds are there. So the doors are going to be open, and it is our responsibility to utilize the opportunity to explore these type of secondary metabolites for commercialization. And even the recent regulations.
But we do also see, because our metabolite profiling of Bacillus valenzensis strains have shown the terpene compounds as a predominant. For example, the prolines were also very much in the predominant, which are also showing a very good antifungal activity.
Okay.
Yeah, of course, we are also in the same process of publishing it. That is the reason I had a curiosity to ask you.
Rather than suppose if you are having some interesting material, because now these biomolecules, that's biostimulant. So the Central Insecticide Board, they have recently issued an order. So the biostimulants can be used for that over-regulation or the stimulation of the secondary metabolite. We can bring it into the biostimulant. So if you are having that opportunity, better plan for a patent. So rather than publishing it immediately. So that may be my sincere advice, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Is there any more question from the audience side? students. If not, now may I request Professor in Health Department of Plant Pathology and Chairman of the Symposium to please felicitate Dr. Nakiran.
Dr. Nakiran, thank you very much for this magnificent talk, and I would like that some of our students in near future, when the situation is a bit better, then they visit your laboratory to learn the things, and our young scientists who are working here. So I will like to your help in this exchange.
Definitely, sir. We are ready. We are always open. And if they are coming, I think they may be the future pillars of the nation. So we can come out with the better microbes, because a single microbe can win the millions of money. So if they are ready to come, we are ready to support them.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now I request our professor in health to please felicitate Dr. Nakiran with a memento. Sir, we will be sending this very soon to your place.
And
to post. So I present our professor in health to. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for your
The next speaker we have Dr. Pankaj Sharma. He is Principal Scientist, ICR, Director of Rapeseed Mustard Research, Bharatpur. Sir, are you there, sir?
Yes, I am here.
Yes. So he will be speaking on trending technologies for Sclerotinia rot management in oilseed brassica. So you may start your presentation, sir.
Sufficiency in the edible oil seeds. Particularly, if you see in the among the different agriculture produce, in the molecular edible oil we are lacking, and every year we are procuring more than 70,000 crore rupees investing on the edible oils. And in edible oils, which is contributing, is the major, is the...
Excuse me, sir. Your slides are not moving, sir.
You can see that in...
Sir, only your title slide is visible, sir. Your presentation is not going ahead. Please
start. Your slides are not moving now.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. No, it is moving. Is it moving?
No, sir. Only the title slide is visible.
Yeah, now it's moving.
Yes, sir.
Is it? Now it has gone to the first slide. Now you please see that, is it moving or not? No, you please go to the next slide, please. No, I am just checking that it is the next slide, then next slide we
change.
No, it is not changing. So I should go once again to presentation. So what, you may better close the presentation and once again you share the slides.
Yeah,
I am doing that. Can you please there? Is it visible? Yeah, the slide is visible. Yeah, just again I'm checking that is it presentation mode? Is it presentation mode? Then changing? It is in the slide mode only. So you can press F5. Is it not changing? You please go to the second slide, sir. It is second slide. No, it is not moving. This is third one. No, it's not moving yet here.
You can scroll.
Yeah, now it moves. So the presentation I'm not going for the presentation mode. Okay, I will go by like this now.
Okay.
Yeah, it changes. So I will keep like this only. Okay, sir. You are convenient. Yeah, because I think in changing slide mode is not changing. Okay. So, discussing about the oilseed residence requirement, we are now focusing on the high productivity of oilseed brassica, and if you see the what are the major losses which are from the industrial mustard are there, if are from the sprouting ester rot, which is one of the minions to contribution of oilseed brassica in the world. Infection occurs on the leaves, as you have seen, and it's goes through all the developmental stages and causing the losses up to 50%. And spontaneous erosion everywhere in the world, it is causing the losses, including Australia, Europe, India, and Northern America. And here, if we see that more than 500 host species are there with the spontaneous erosion, so difficult to manage the disease, particularly with a single kind of strategy of management. So different integrated disease management module we have to develop to control the disease. So here in different states where we are growing the rapeseed mustard currently, particularly in Punjab, Himachal, Haryana, Rajasthan, Bihar and other, even northern eastern states are there where the sclerotinia problem is the major problem. If we globally see the what kind of dosage are there, we can see that there are dosages of 50 to 70%, and in Australia it is ranging 3.9 to 1.54 ton per hectare. In China the dosage are reported up to 10 to 20%, while in India if we see different states, 100% dosage are reported in sick floors or where the major disease where the dosage are there. In particular in Punjab, 2% and in Uttar Pradesh, 72% of dosage are reported.
In Rajasthan, we have 50% of rapeseed mustard, particularly the Indian mustard we are growing. We have very times we have reported when the congenital condition of disease is there. 60% doses are reported in the Rajasthan for the supporting age of mustard. So this is the one of the seed group where you can see that the entire crop of the more than 3 hectare area has been totally damaged by sprouting explosion during the maturity time, where there is no single grain harvesting was there from this field. This is a farmer's field photograph we have taken. And if you see the different symptoms as I have discussed you earlier, when you see this picture, how the ESCO is supposed to be, because the sprouting explosion is the ESCOMYCETES fungus is producing sexually and asexually. When it comes in, the sexual germination is there in the apothecia and giving rise to the ESCO spores. These ESCO spores, they have taken the nutrition from the petals, shredded petals. And you see that on the leaf, there, very early, first photograph on the left hand side on upper portion is that the black spores they are seen there. All around there was the pathogen sector, that is the oxalic acid production, and this gives rise to the yellow halo all around the black spores. Later on, the leaf itself and on the juncture of the stem, there is the mycelial, white mycelial growth we have seen in the next photograph. Coming to the downward photographs, you can see on the ports, there is where the ESCO spore touches and some petals were there with, on the juncture of that pod and the leaf axil. They have the same infection exposure and this results to the rotting of entire silica of the pod. Later, if you see on the even on the soil surface, in the soil surface where the petals have been shredded and the ESCO spore comes downward, and so that the mycelial growth on the all the ground part is there. Is covering with the white mycelial growth, and the formation of sclerotia is there from the stem on the outside. Inside where the plant sclerotia are there, even on the roots, the sclerotia are formed. So this is the symptoms where, as in the disease cycle, you find that the sclerotia, which is mixed with the some kind of seeds are there, they can give rise to the need to sexually and asexually giving to the high three hypothecia and causing the same disease cycle, and even 1 to 13 years the disease process even be perpetuated in the soil when the congenital condition is there. So very big task for the plant pathologist to control the sclerotinia explosion with a single kind of strategy. So if we come to the pathogen, how this pathogen ESCOMYCETES is reacting, if we have done the 75 different geographic isolates we are maintaining in the country, where in our laboratory we have taken their morphological parameters, and we find that there are different groups of sclerotinia are there, which is not similar in all of the country, where some are more aggressive, virulent are there, some are less virulent. Avirulent isolates are, geographical isolates are, there is no any, one is the avirulent, but they are more friendly, they are different kind of reactions we have given. If you see the mycelial compatibility of all the 75 geographical isolates, there were more than 5,625 pairings for there with the 75 geographical isolates. And among these 433 combinations, they have showed the bone fibrogens. Only 7.8% of their all the combinations were the compatible. So here we can see that how the pathogen they are reacting with the mycelial compatibility. And we have also found that isolate 1, 2, and 3, they are most compatible with the other isolates. So among these 18 isolates, 75 geographical isolates, they are compatible with other isolates, and this strongly indicated the predominant factor of incompatibility at the whole population level of the sprouting dysplasia. And if we come to the genetic diversity, all the isolates, among these 65 geographical isolates we have taken for the genetic diversity studies, and we have found from this dendrogram there were 4 groups of the pathogen were there, which we have categorized into highly virulent, virulent, and moderately virulent, and these are accordingly different states, particularly Asia growing states like Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Haryana, Punjab, like we have categorized with them. So we can easily remark that these are the more virulent pathogens, which are, when we come to the how the genome sequencing of this pathogen is doing so far, unpublished data I am putting here, and here the one geographic lifestyle which is having the highly prevalent the ESR 01 is from the our network from Bharatpur, was the sequenced and the assembly size of more than 1041 MB with 1028 scaffold having 10 MB of more than 4.4 was obtained through a DNA assembly as a high quality mix. Total of 4,9469 protein coding genes were predicted from genome assembly, and we have compared it with the against the 1980 isolate of this proteinase process was from the Brassica nervus kind of another Brassica species. So this is in the genomics, Journal of Genomics under publication, and published data, and we come to the epidemiology, and we have given the farmers a kind of perfect strategy how to manage the disease. So first we have taken different last 12 years, 13 years we are doing the experiment on different needs of sowing, and we took the petals shredded petals since the different sowing dates, and these petals were collected even from 23rd of December to the last shedding of the petals in the month of January. And the different petals we have collected, and we found that whenever which date the petal we have collected, which means that you have seen the central portion of the petal plate, where you can find that the sclerotia is germinating, that giving to the kind of sclerotia and mycelial growth is there. So maximum 22nd October sowing and 29th October sowing, where the maximum petals were shredded during that convenient period, you will find that the sclerotinase portion is more aggressive. So combination of high relative humidity, low bright sunshine hours, and high soil moisture during the critical stage kind of 60 to 70 days of the growth favors the highest proteinuria of incidence. And you can see in the field, in the right photograph, the, how the apothecia there comes out from the soil on the sclerotia, and the different weather variables which affects the sclerotinia incidence was in the particular in the first to third standard week, means the first portrait of the January is the particular in peculiar giving the congenial condition to the development of the this disease. So farmer, they find the growth at the time of maturity when the plants plug down, and at that time there is no any kind of management strategy we can adopt. So management we have to do during this period only 60 to 70 days of growth, so that we can easily manage the disease at this stage. So different forecasting models we have developed from all these epidemiological data published in the journals, and the disease management strategy when it comes, then you will find that the different management strategies, even including the cultural control, is not only the cultural control, we can manage the disease, but due to the persistent nature of sclerotia and even monocropping of the mustard or rapeseed mustard in the all over the different major Brassica growing areas, you will find that every year the farmers they are growing mustard after mustard, so the number of sclerotia is increasing every year. In the chemical control, we go only for the chemical control, different kind of resistance in the insecticidal application, or even the farmers they did not like to give a foliar application at the time of Aspergillus foliar, this time when there are crop is in full bloom and farmer they cannot without power spray they did not control or go for the spray of any kind of fungicides or biocides. So resistant variety is one of the important things which we can focus more on the potential and economic sustainable method of control, where we are working on that, and in cultural control. Earlier farmers they are using the 30 cm to 30 cm for the row to row spacing, and even plant to plant spacing the farmers they are giving the most seed even 5 to 6 kg of seed per hectare. Now we have come to it that the quantity of seed and now the farmers the development of the mustard seeder which we have developed this prototype from Bharatpur, and the farmers can use this prototype and can sow the seed up even to 2.5 kg per hectare from this machine without getting anything. So the plant population now will be there less, and the row to row spacing will also increase, so then give the significant result to comes the lower the disease pressure. So among that cultural control, one of the amount of frequency of irrigation that farmers, they are giving the frequent irrigation even after the second irrigation when the continued condition is there for the disease development. At that time, they are giving the irrigation which causes the loss to the crop. So, irrigation management strategy we have also developed for the cultural control, and for that we have done that day from 25th of December to the 15th of January, when there is particularly the continued time for the sexual germination of the Apothecia and Aspis for release. At that time, we can check the soil moisture, then there will be more Escherichia, they will form into the Apothecial bodies. So, management experiment we have conducted for the more than 5 to 6 years, and then we have taken different kinds of modules we have tested after that one, and now perfectly we can give that the seed treatment and foliar spray with the carbendazim, or if they now the chances of carbendazim again in the restricted fungicide, then hexaconazole we have taken, that tebuconazole we have taken. So all these newer fungicides we have also tested and found that the seed treatment with carbendazim or seed treatment with trichoderma, or we can go for foliar spray or the tebuconazole only even at the 0.1% can easily manage the disease. So this is the mixed kind of the integrated combination of the disease management, and this is popularized among the farmers with the different kind of MGMG programs, Miragram, Miragorov, and other different farmers training program, and even we have taken our power sprayer from our institute to the farmers field, and we have shown how we can go for the spray of the ebuconazole or carbendazim or even the trichoderma foliar spray. So seed treatment and as well as the irrigation management with the perfect sowing of the row-to-row spacing and plant-to-plant spacing can easily manage the disease. Now the part one which is very important is the resistance, and since last 12 years more than 5,000 different brassica germplasm collected from different sources, even from the NDPGR, we have screened for the artificial stem inoculation that was standardized here at ICR-DRMR, and we have conducted the different Junsia, different carinata or different nervous species, and even in the which is we are having the major brassica Junsia species in cultivation Indian mustard, they have also found some good tolerance in the Indian mustard also. So this screening we have done during the time of first week of the January or end of the December. In end of December we started and go up to the mid of the January, and in that period in every each line of germ plant we taken the 5 plants with the stem inoculation, which is having the mycelial plug on that 5 mm mycelial plug with the cotton swab, most cotton swab with wrapped with the paraffin at the height of juncture of around 20 to 25 cm from the soil level. And after 3 weeks of inoculation, we go for the observations, different observations, kind of lesion size, kind of percentage incidence we have reported. You will see here that SIP plot which we have developed at our institute for the sclerotinia screening. You can see that even the entire soil of that SIP plot will find that mycelial growth is there on during the infection period when there is more number of Escherichia, Apothecia and Ascospores releases, and they will give the. So this is done in the SIP plot, and you can see the how the susceptible reactions of the brassica is there, having the lesion size goes up to the more than 1.2 meters size of the lesion size is there, however we require only less than 3 centimeters for the tolerance. So this is the susceptible reactions, and you can see here in the tolerant reactions some of the exotic lines, even our Indian line that is RH1228, some of lines from our institute DRMR360, DRMR1035143 93, and all others. Even 8 or 9 lines we have particularly repeatedly we have spent last since 3-4 years, and we found that these are having some good tolerance with the Sclerotinia. And these which are showing good kind of tolerance, we have also taken for the leaf detection technique, and detached leaf we have inoculated, and same kind of results we have also observed in the filter sleep. Given it is not a perfect technique, filter sleep to take the scrutiny is crucial. And some courses we have attempted because they are the parameters of this, but we are also engaged with some kind of breeding work and the highly tolerant germ plan we have taken with the highly potential varieties and we have close them and taken the F1. You can see in the second picture where the Rowanin is highly susceptible to Sclerotinia when it is processed. One of the ordinate carinata DRMR261, then we have found some kind of growth of tumor kind of growth is there on the stem where the entire check of the Sclerotinia is there. So such kind of cases we have also observed, and now we are in the process of the development of recombinant inbred lines, and we are in the F4 and F5 stages where we are taking the one of exotic line 5-7-7-3-2-8 with the high-yielding Brassica densia RS749, and these 256 plants which are in the now F5 population stage we are given, and we have taken the QPLs of all these lines. So, in one of our international projects which are running on the Sclerotinia along with the NIPP, National Institute of Plant Biotechnology, we have also taken the samples for the transcriptome profiling, and we have taken the one susceptible, that is NRCHB101, and one tolerant RH1228, and we have on different time zones of 24 hours, 48, 26 hours, we have taken the RNA samples from the plants, and we are in the analysis of the transcriptome profiling of these extended organ sources. So after complete bioinformatic analysis, we will be able to predict the potential target genes, and after validation of target genes of your DPCR RGS, it will be the lead for the further investigation and the application. So work is in the progress, and some of the green population which I have already discussed, and we have taken for that the UPL methods in molecular approach. So we have taken 160 individuals where we can stain for their UPLs, and this is the figure which is showing that both even in people plants. So where we are now is, if we can come to the conclusion that where we are now. So we can see that more than 5,000 Brassica germplasm were screened in the last years, and we have found some good tolerance in the different Brassica, including the Brassica thuringia. We started to develop the recombinant inbred lines, and we have gone for the mating on quantitative bred grow size, confirming the resistance to Sclerotinia using the repopulation and using the process. And if we, what kind of requirement is now there? So we can go, we have a host differential set, then we can go for community, the current and new pathotypes distributions. Even we have included all different types of areas where the major Brassica growing areas are there. We have collected the sources from there. Then identify the resistance against the predominant pathotypes and combine the resistance to the different pathotypes in the future cultivars. So the work is in progress, even for the effective genes, and we are also working on the bioinformatic parts of this protein exclusion, and the work is in progress. Hopefully within the coming years, within 2 or 3 years, we will be able to give some kind of good material even in the farmer's field for the Sclerotinia organs. So this is all about the Sclerotinia sclerosium, which is a major disease of the rapeseed mustard. So once again, I am thankful to organizers and welcome for any question.
Dr. Kambesh Sharma sir, an excellent presentation has been given from you, and we just
really appreciate it.
Sir, you have given an excellent presentation, starting from development of forecasting models, the variability among the pathogens, and explaining about the management using cultural methods, then chemical methods, then using resistance screening and recombinant inbred lines, and explaining the whole genome sequence and the marker behind isolation of these different resistant DNAs and all those things. So I think this is a very good work which has been the need of the hour for the prowess of your mustard. since I have also had an opportunity to work in University of Manitoba for more than 2 years in this particular project. So this is sort of an interesting and pathogen really, which has both the ascospore production, then apothecial production, everything. So it's a very, very tricky pathogen for management. So really, thanks for your excellent presentation, sir. Now it is open for the discussion for the participants, please.
Dr. Sharma, I have a question for you. You have mentioned that you have used this carbendazim for the management of sclerotinia rot at the rate of 0.2%. So normally we use it maximum 0.1%. So have you noticed any phytotoxic effect or something like that?
For tebuconazole?
No, for carbendazim, sir. It was 0.2%. You have used 0.2%.
0.2% means it is the 50% WP. So it's kind of a, if we go for the 0.2%, then it will be effective. Even different doses, 0.1 and 0.2 we have taken. Okay. So 2 gram per kg of seed and 2 gram per liter of water we have used for the spray.
So
as according to the pesticide bill which has been passed in 2021, they have going to remove carbon dioxide. So I think better some alternate biomasses. I think we have also worked on
Hyprodeon and molecule also they have worked.
Ketoconazole we have found, and even Hypoderma 10 gram per kg of seed we are going for the seed treatment. And even Trichoderma is not some kind of managing more than 90%, but even 60 to 65% when we go for the foliar spray at the time of ascospore, it is also managing with the Trichoderma also.
And tamsulazole is also quite effective, sir.
Yeah, bacillus, we can go.
The subtils are also performing better. Based on the data, I was able to.
Thank
you, madam. And once again, I thanks to all the organizers
for the
beautiful conference and giving me the opportunity to interact with you.
Thank you, sir. Now, I would request our professor and head, Department of Plant Pathology, to please felicitate Dr. Sharma by presenting him a memento and also say a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Sharma.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
For this nice talk. And because the area where you are working, there we need such approaches for this soil-borne plant pathogens. I want to say thank on behalf of all the organizing committee that despite of your illness and this thing that you braved all the odds and you are with us. So our good wishes for your speedy recovery, and thank you very much.
Sir, this is a token of respect from our side to Dr. Sharma. So we'll be sending it soon to your place, sir. Post also.
Okay, Dr. Pankaj, take care. Huh?
Thank you, Dr. Sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Wish you a speedy recovery, sir. And thank you so much for your dedication. Next speaker we have Dr. Pavan Kumar Sharma. He is Principal Scientist in National Bureau of Agriculturally Important Microorganisms at MAU. Dr. Sharma is the alumnus of UHF Noni. Sir, it's very nice to have you here, sir. Dr. Sharma, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, sir. So Dr. Sharma will be speaking on microbial resources centers and their role in meeting sustainable goals. So, over to you, sir. Please start your presentation.
नहीं नहीं जीवित
नहीं हुई.
Yes, sir. No, it's not.
Are slides visible?
No, sir. Not visible.
Not visible?
No, sir.
But no, I think you have not yet uploaded anything, sir. You are presenting to everyone. It comes here.
Have you opened your presentation, sir? First, you open your presentation on desktop and minimize it. Then you go to that presentation.
ओपन करके फिर
यस सर नाउ इट्स विजिबल यस सर यस सर
या नाउ इट इज विजिबल
प्रेजेंटेशन
गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन वेल टू स्टार्ट विद आई वुड से दैट द ईयर 2020 वाज डिक्लेयर्ड एज इंटरनेशनल ईयर ऑफ प्लांट हेल्थ बाय द यूनाइटेड नेशंस. The Conservation of Biological Diversity was signed in 1992 and it came into force in 1994. One of the first objectives or the goals of this treaty was conservation of geoplankton, biological diversity, which includes plants, animals. In the text of this convention, there are references to microorganisms. But I would say that the microorganisms haven't received as much attention as they should have so far as the conservation is concerned. There are a number of interest sites. Since I am working at the Bureau and we have been at the lecture here, so I have chosen to speak on the topic of microbial resource centers and their role in making sustainable development goals. Now, microbial resources. Now, any strain which is authenticated, taxonomically defined, physiologically characterized, quality controlled, and well documented, that is referred to as a microbial resource. Now, it has been estimated that there are about a trillion species of microorganisms. But 99% of the microbial species still remain undiscovered and unexplored. And up till now, we have been able to culture only about 1% of the bacteria, which means 99% of the, we do not have any information about the 99% of the bacterial species. So this is the present situation. Not so far as the culture collections are concerned, they perform different roles. For example, deposition of the microorganisms, their documentation, preservation and maintenance, and then distributing those cultures to different stakeholders. Now there are different two types of culture collections. One is conventional culture collection. What they do is that they just maintain the microbial cultures and distribute it to different stakeholders. Then there are microbial resource centers, which are microbial biological resource centers. But besides the preservation or conservation of the microbial geoplankton, they perform other duties also. For example, they do have knowledge, expert knowledge on microbial cultivation systematics. They do have knowledge about the intellectual property rights, and they also keep in with the biosafety and biosecurity aspects. Now, the first culture collection was established in 1590 by Professor Francis A. Kral. And in 1970, World Federation for Culture Collections came into being. Now, as of today, there are 79 in 76 countries. And the total number of microbial holdings is 3.2 million, including fungal, bacteria, viruses, and cell lines. And only about 131 culture collections are listed with World Federation for culture collections. Now we are talking about a trillion species. Now we have the microbial holding only 3.2 million. Because that, lot of information is there, lot of cultures are there in our country also, but that is lying with those researchers also. So that cannot be referred to as a microbial resource because that is not well documented. Nobody others know what those cultures are. Not so far as the total number of microbial holdings are concerned, well, USA comes at number 1 and we are at number 4. Earlier we were at number 5 and earlier we were at number 4. And the total number of holdings in our culture collections, it is 2,19,961 as of today. And USA comes at, China is at number 2 and the Denmark is at number 10. Now in our country, as of today, there are 32 culture collections.
And out of these 32 culture collections, 3 culture collections have they deal with patent deposits also. And out of these 32, 13 are distributing the cultures to others also. Because out of these 32 culture collections, there are very small culture collections also. They are not distributing the cultures, but they are registered with them. Registered with the World Data Center for Microorganisms and is a member of World Federation of Culture Collections. And they are from consultancy also, they are identification books are also being provided and they are conducting training also from time to time. So this is just to give you the brief of the culture collection that we have in our country. Now those which are indicated in red, these are very important culture collections and big culture collections, for example, MS Swaminathan Research Foundation, Delhi University, Mycological Harvesting, Indian Time Culture Collection, Microbial Culture Collection, then Microbial Time Culture Collection and Gene Bank, and then National Agriculture Important Microbial Culture Collection. Now, Budapest Treaty. Not so far as microbial, then we talk about microbial, we talk about patent, then this treaty comes into picture, which is, and this treaty was signed in 1977 and it entered into force in 1980. And India became signatory to this treaty in 2001. And as of today, 85 countries are party to this treaty. But the name of this treaty is Budapest Treaty for the International Declaration of the Deposit of Microorganisms for the Purposes of Patent Procedure. Now, under the Indian Patent Act 1970, microbes cannot be patented. But microbial products or microbial processes can be patented. So if you have a microbial process, then certain requirements have to be fulfilled. Now under this, certain culture collections have been put in the status of International Depository Authority. Now before you apply for a patent for a microbiological process, the first thing that is to be required to be done is that that which has to be deposited in a culture collection which has the status of IDA. Now that IDA will give a registration number and that registration number has to be quoted in the patent application. Then you will be granted the patent. Now say for example, now what is the advantage of this treaty? Say for example, you are applying for a patent, you want to apply for a patent in 20 countries. You will apply for a patent in 20 countries, but you will have to deposit the culture only in one culture collection which has the IDA status. Earlier, the need was that you had to deposit the culture in all the countries and all the countries where you are applying for a patent. So it obligates the need to deposit the culture in different culture collections. The deposit in one culture collection satisfies the patent needs of all the countries so that you will be applying the patent. Now as of today there are 48 culture collections have been given the status of IDA. These are in 27 countries and majority of them are in Europe. In our country, there are 3 culture collections have been given the status of IDA. The one is Microbial Time Culture Collection and Gene Bank. It was conferred this status in 2002. Another one is National Center for Microbial Resource in 2011. And the third one is National Agriculture and Water Microbial Culture Protection, which was conferred the status of IDA in July 2020. Now, say for example, if someone wants to deposit this material, or to glyphosate patent and wants to deposit in our culture collection, then these are the microbes that we are accepting, bacteria, fungi, and group cyanobacteria. And this is just to give you a glimpse of the microbes, then we will be accepting plasmid, bacteria, and chlorpha also. Now, the first culture collection, it is a very important and very big culture collection, and this culture collection was given the status of IDA 31st of January 1981. And this is a very big culture collection and very old culture collection. Another culture collection is DSMZ, German Collection for Microorganisms and Cell Cultures. Third one is CABI. It also has the status of IDA. The China Center for Time Culture Collections. MBCC is a very important culture collection from the, there are many cultures which are important from the industrial point of view and these have been deposited in this culture collection. Microbial Culture Collection, which is now called as Microbial Center, its name now has changed. And then National Collection of Microorganisms. National Fungal Culture Collection of India. And there are specialized culture collection, cultures also. For example, culture collection of Arbuscular Mycorrhizal Fungi, then collection of Arbuscular Mycorrhizal Fungi, Industrial East Collection, Marine Culture Collection of China, Agriculture Culture Collection of China. And that, you know, specialized culture collections are also there. Now, in so far as the agriculture of agricultural important microorganism is concerned, well, this was established in 2001 at New Delhi, and it was shifted to its present issue in 2004. Now we have a collection here. We have a microgenomic resource repository, and we have a microgenetic resource portal where you will get a lot of useful information. And we have then laboratories also, and we are doing a job for the CIBRC also, so far as the biopesticide characterization is concerned. And we have a network project, one of the biggest network project of microbiology in the country, which is being funded from our bureau. And through this project, for the first time, microbiologists have from different parts of the country have come on one platform. Now this, these are the objectives of our bureau. One is exploration of agriculturally important microorganisms, their identification, characterization, documentation, their conservation, maintenance, and utilization, and then the whole resource development. Now as of today, we have a microbiome of 7,200 microbes, comprising about 400 fungi, about 700 bacteria, and we have got a very good collection of cyanobacteria also in our repository. And you know, this under the national under the biodiversity act, the National Biodiversity Authority has identified, recognized our bureau as a national repository for agriculturally important microorganisms. This is just to give you the diversity of the microbes, give you a glimpse of the diversity that we have in our culture collection. Now here, what I would like to do, now I was talking about CABI, which is looking at not a status of IBA. Now, in 2009-10, about 1400 cultures, I told you, this were retrieved by our company from CABI, from UK. And you will be surprised to know that some of the cultures were deposited by the Indian Research Institute in 1947, 1950, 1953, 1960, and these cultures were maintained at CABI, and now these cultures are lying with us. Now, most of our microbial wealth is lying in other countries also, and they are not going to return it because they know what is the importance of the microbial wealth. Now, so far as our company is concerned, and so far as the conservation of microbial wealth of the country is concerned, well, I think we woke up late to this aspect, and now a lot of efforts are being made to conserve this microbial wealth, which is priceless. Now we have a good collection of mushroom cultures also, comprising Agaricus, Hypocyzicus, Cyanophyllum, and Oyster species. So we have about 21 genera of cyanobacteria in our culture collection. Now the microbacteria in our culture collection have been collected by the researchers from different states of the country, from different habitats, ranging from soil, water, cold streams, cold deserts, and cold soil. Now this is just giving scientists our bureau who have visited different habitats to collect this one. Now the country collection has got linkages with the different institutes. Now in our healthy collection, we are preserving the microbes through different methods, short-term and long-term methods. We are preserving the fungi in mineral oil, short-term storage, then fungi and bacteria in glacial rock and storing them in mice kitty. And then the long term, this is our lyophilization facility. All the microbes have been lyophilized and being maintained at 4 degrees C. And we have got a small facility at New Delhi also. And there we are preserving these microbes in liquid nitrogen. Not all the microbes have been conserved in liquid nitrogen, but we have started preserving them in liquid nitrogen also. Now the services that we are being provided, first is that we are accepting the microbes almost from all the states of the country. The researchers have deposited the cultures under general category. Then we are supplying the cultures to academia, to industry and other stakeholders. Now we have got a facility for a registration of elite microbes also. And another is we have a safe facility for safe deposition of microbes. Someone wants that, you know, they have a very important culture and they cannot maintain it themselves, then they can send it to us and we will keep it safely. And then, of course, then we are providing services for current prices for both CIB and RC. Now, here I would like to say that if you go back a few years, then there was chaos in the bulk market in our country. Chaos in the sense that nobody was knowing what is being sold in the market. But about 3 years back, insecticide board and registration committee took the decision that all the companies which were registered their microbes under the formulations under the insecticide act, and those companies which have already registered their products, they would have to submit, they have been made mandatory that all of these companies will submit their microbes to the bureau for the DMS security. Now a good beginning, and all the companies are submitting their samples to us. We are DMS printing it. We are charging for that. At least good beginning has been made, and we have got some database on the biopesticide which are available in the market and which are being registered by the CIB and FASC. Now, sometimes the question is how do we, for example, if you want to deposit your culture, then get the procedure that we follow. Once we receive a culture, we immediately email that person that, okay, we have received your culture. and then after that, what we do is that we check the viability and purity, and once we are certified that it is a pure culture, then after that, we send a depositor check along with the culture to the depositor, and we ask him whether it is the same culture that you have deposited or is it a different culture. If you say that it is the same culture, then it is pure culture. Then after that we assign the accession number, and that certificate is given to that person, the culture is reserved. So this is the passport data for submission of microbe to our culture collection. Only thing is that in the case of fungi, an IDSC testing has to be done. In the case of bacteria, the minimum need is that it should have been identified based on 16S ribosomal RNA gene. Now this is just a view of the passport data that deposited. Then after that the depositor says that okay, it is identical and it is fine with the certain cultures that he had deposited, then the accession number is granted. Now we have the facility for the, if you think that you have got a very unique microorganism, it is unique, distinct and stable. Of course it will not be stable in this term which we use in the case of plant variety, because stability cannot be guaranteed. But if you think that it is novel, then you can submit it here and it will register it for a period of 10 years. There is a joint plasma registration committee, and we send that proposal to 4 experts and seek their views before giving the registration, then the registration certificate is given to them. Now this is just to tell you about our catalogs which are available online also. This is the database that we use for cataloging the cultures that we see. Now this is the resource portal, right? The microbe genetic resource portal, you will get a lot of information on this portal. Now this is the, if you are depositing the general deposit category, then it is free of cost, no fee to charge. Then we are providing the identification also. Then you have any evaluation of biomaterials also. And if you want a culture, if you want, we are supplying the culture, then for research institutes, the charge is 1600 rupees per culture, and it is 1200 rupees per private institution. And so far as the registration is concerned, again, we are not charging any fee to the registration of my. Now, so far as the reserve area or microorganism is concerned, when it comes under the Biological Diversity Act. Now, I will not go into the details of it, but I would like to highlight one point. Say, for example, you know, people are working on bacteria, some people are working on fungi. Now, if you have a novel fungus, or if you have come out with a novel or new bacterial species, now, to be recognized as a new bacterial species, what you have to do is that you have to show positivity and submit it to National Biodiversity Authority. And the need is, before you deposit it, you have to seek the permission from the National Biodiversity Authority. And the requirement is, the culture that the new bacterial species that you have, it has to be deposited in two culture collections having the IDA status. In two different countries, say for example, Indian researcher, he can deposit his culture in Indian repository and another foreign country, say for example, in Germany, he can deposit it. After he deposits it, the article has to be mandatorily published in International Journal of Systematic and Industrial Microbiology to be considered as a direct publication. Up to this point, it is okay. Now, after this problem arises, now you have your new culture in the German culture collection. A researcher from UK wants to use that culture for research work. Now, the National Biodiversity Act says that the researchers from UK have to seek permission from National Biological Diversity Authority for taking the culture from German culture collection. Now, all the European culture collections say that we do not agree with this provision because the research materials should be freely available to the researchers. And that is why the Law of the Biological Diversity Act is under it is being implemented and from making certain amendments, deliberation in this regard have taken place because this provision has the potential to impede the research. Now I am presenting a statistics here, which is a very green statistics. Now, so far as the ground reality is concerned, well, about 21 million people were hungry. 49 million people, children were suffering from waste food. About 140 million children were stunted. Now, see, this is the 2019 World Poverty situation. The sustainable goal target is to get 1.7 people per second out of extreme poverty, but the current escape rate is 0.5 people per second. And as of October 2019, for every 45 people, escape rate is, that escape of poverty, 15 people fall into poverty each. Now, from 20 to 2015, we have Millennium Development Goal, and a lot of progress was made under these goals, so far as eradication of hunger and reduction of poverty is concerned. But these goals were applicable to developing countries also. In 2016, all the countries came together, they set goals which are called as Sustainable Development Goals, and these are applicable in all the countries. And all these goals are interlinked. The first goal is low poverty, eradication of poverty. Second is eradication of hunger. And third one is good health and well-being. Now, these goals have been categorized into five categories: people, land, peace, prosperity, and partnership. Now, just hurriedly, I'll give you an idea. Now, so far as microorganisms do have it, although I have said that micro, they are not getting as much attention as possible, and so far as the achievement of these goals are concerned, then this microbes do have an important role to play. For example, eradication of poverty. Now, for income generation, you know, in different countries, microbes are being utilized. For example, global gas production by methane-producing organisms. I will hurriedly go because I think I have overshot the time. Zero hunger. Now, for zero hunger, for example, making of pickles. For soil fertility, we do know that your mycorrhizal fungi, then phosphates, soluble bacteria, nitrogen-fixing bacteria, do play a very important role. Third one is good health and well-being. Now, prebiotics and probiotics. New drugs. Your pharmaceutical industries, their microbes are playing a very important role. Gastrointestinal flora prevention of disease like gastroenteritis, then use of probiotics and prebiotics. Now, quality education, this is very, very important. Now, it is very, so far as microbes are concerned, as far as, you know, man on the street is concerned, well, they do not know anything about the role of the microbe. Therefore, in this regard, not only the man on the street has to be made aware about the importance of microorganisms, but, you know, microbiology and microbiological education also has to be emphasized at the school level also. Now, gender equality is very important, and microbes do play a very important role. Now, you must have heard about, you know, genital mutilation in some of the African countries. You know, people have to be made aware that, you know, it leads to many infections. Then income generation also, when, you know, income generation, people are engaged, for example, preservation of food and pharmaceutical, you know, they earn themselves, and it leads to gender equality also. And secondly, the women, you know, who are microbiologists, those women have also to be empowered and given, you know, leadership positions. You know, that contributed a lot about gender equality. Clean water and sanitation, microbes do cause a lot of disease, but at the same time, you know, they are involved in the production of these vaccines also. Now, we are going through, for example, we are going through a pandemic which is caused by SARS-CoV-2. Now, the vaccines that we are using, they are based on microbiology. Sputnik 5, that we have published, the adenovirus has been used as a vector. Affordable and clean energy. No electricity generation is there. Research on use of microbes in electricity generation is going on. Decent work and economic is the eighth goal. From industry innovation and infrastructure, biofertilizers. We all know that, you know, biofertilizers industry plays a very, very important role so far as the soil health is concerned. Various microbes products are being made by applying different microbes. Now, this equality, agriculture and land management practicing, it has been proven that whenever, you know, people are given the property rights and they are educated, so the yield increases. And therefore, the point is that, you know, they should be given, you know, talk about the importance of soil microflora, because they are engaged in agriculture and it will constitute the productivity. No, sustainable city and communication. Under the soft heart of that also, you know, a lot of waste could be being composted. In plains, we are using microbiomes where microbes are being used. And so, the microbes, they can play a very important role in having your sustainable city community. It's responsible consumption and production. It is very, very important, because it will definitely affect all other goals. From government actions, microbes play a very, very important role. Now, for example, nitrogen fertilizers are being used. It leads to depletion of soil health also, as well as, you know, it leads to global warming also. And if a part of chemical fertilizers are supplanted by the biofertilizer, then definitely it will contribute towards climate change mitigation. Then these are the other goals. Now, here I have given you the specific example where people are earning through the use of microbes. Now, in the end, I will say that since nature has the most sustainable ecosystem, and since ultimately agriculture comes out of nature, our standard for sustainable growth should be nature's own ecosystem. Thank you very much.
Dr. Sharma ji, thank you for your very good presentation on how to really, your lecture was really highlighting all the experts and all the researchers how best we can go for preserving our microbes and how best we can explore that for the national development. And all the patenting issues related to the microbials and the very early organisms, long-term preservation, short-term preservation, the need for educating the students at the school level to emphasize about the microbial health, and all the other things was very well explained, including the role of our National Biodiversity Authority was also highlighted. And thanks for your lecture, sir. And I think now it is open for the discussion, and any questions from the participant side, may kindly
throw to Dr. Sharma ji. Suppose you are having 100 bulbs of such a gap of twice. And if any same what one culture of a gap of twice from you, then which culture will provide to them?
It is here.
No, because we have usually 100 classes, we will be asking you because we have a catalog. So we will be asking you that you tell the accessible of the classes that you want. Okay? Because otherwise, if you are not giving the accessible, then you say that you just want the culture again, by sports, you will be any culture. But generally, when anybody asks for a culture, he quotes the accessible number of that culture, and based on that, you check the viability and security of that culture, and then we supply it to the concerned person.
Okay, thank you.
Dr. Sharma, I have a basic question. How much time does it take to get the accession number from your center if we deposit the culture?
We assign the accession number as soon as possible. Say, for example, within 1 month we find you. This is our legal within the permanent. But now, these days will be taking a lot of time for us because of the important problem and also because the staff is not coming. Because sometimes it's often people are selecting 50 cultures or 60 cultures at a time. Now, each and every culture has kept for its purity. At the same time, another person is asking that I will do 40 cultures. But always we will try that we should be able to satisfy the person that assigns the number things have slowed down considerably. We are also not very good about all these things. But we always try that we should give the accessing number as soon as possible.
Have you come across recently any LH microbe which has been registered, sir?
This year we have lots of air microorganisms which are under consideration. And okay. we have sent it to the experts. Some of the reports we have received and some of the experts have not yet given their reports. And once we get the report, then these reports, the cases put up before the DDC conference. There is a microbial journal about the administration committee. Then after that, when it is prepared by the MDRC, then we give the registration certificate. But up till now, 7 or 8 cases are working, but we are being processed. We are waiting some of the reports from some of the experts. Some have sent their reports.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, Dr. Pawan. I am Ritu Mahabhar from Jodhpur.
Okay,
मेरे को सिर्फ ये बता दीजिए, 1 मिनट ऊपर हो गया है हमारा कल्चर का टेम्पररी रजिस्ट्रेशन नंबर तो दे दिया है आपने, लेकिन ऐसा क्या बता रहे हैं बिकॉज ऑफ कोविड यू डिड चेंज द रिकंजरिंग
और
कंफर्मेशन
आपने मैडम कब भेजा था
एडमिट
हम मेजर हुए तो काफी टाइम हो गया पर आपने टेम्पररी रजिस्ट्रेशन नंबर तो आपने प्रोवाइड कर दिया है बट यू डिड चेंज द हार्ड कॉपी विद द सेम कल्चर फॉर रीचेकिंग फ्रॉम आवर साइड.
Excuse me, Dr. Ritu, you can talk to him later on.
We are going to cut him out of here, but we have a staff here. Some staff is coming from here. So, we assure that your culture is pure and everything is okay, access to the number is
given. Even I sent the culture 3 times. Only one culture.
Hello?
Hello,
ma'am. Excuse me, Madam Ritu. Excuse me. Dr. Sharma, we are getting late for the next session. Please.
Personal questions can be asked.
Yeah, you can ask.
Official communications. This may be a common platform where certain common issues may be discussed.
Yes, sir. Now, I would like to request our professor in head, Dr. H.R. Gautam, to please felicitate Dr. Sharma by presenting him a memento from our side. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Sharma, for your nice delegation.
I also thank the organizers for having me in this symposium and giving me the opportunity to speak to you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. And we are very thankful to our chairman of the session, Dr. S. Nathiran, and also the co-chairman and all our lead speakers who have put in so much efforts for this wonderful delegation. Thanks to one and all. And now I would like to request Dr. S. Nathiran to please give brief remarks about the session.
Thank you, madam, for this opportunity. So, this particular technical session 3 comprised of three lectures. One is from our insight and future role of endophytes in plant health management, which was delivered by Rachana. And the second was on the microbial consortia of Hyderabad, which was delivered by myself. And third one was Dr. Pandit Sharma. So he was explaining about the trending technologies for sclerotinia rot management in oils in Brassica. And finally, Dr. Sharma, so he was explaining what is the role of microbial resource centers, their role in meeting the sustainable goals in relation to agriculture. Ultimately, all these speakers have really enriched the knowledge what is really happening at the pathological perspectives, which is leading to beyond 2020. So, based on this, as my inference that I have received is, whoever may be having an unique practice or who may think that your culture is going to be highly superior and all those things, kindly use the privilege of ICR, NBA, MAHO, so that those microbial resources will definitely help you to grow and help the nation to grow. So that this has to be properly targeted, unless because application alone does not help us. If organisms registering with the business centers of the like Intech and take the nation to the next level for commercialization of the microbial process and the metabolites and the bio molecules associated in this microbes. I think in long run, we expect the collaboration of P.K. Sharma, that his support will definitely take all the researchers to go in a better direction of registering the product. Because all the things that they are having hundreds of microbes in them, which is not coming into the national repository, which does not play any role for the total community of the research community. So, I thank once again the organizers and the observers and the participants for the seminar, and to use this opportunity to submit your cultures to NBA and it is not the impact phase. So, thanks for the organizers once again for the impact of the evening. And the co-chair, Sharma, you can throw some lights on this about this particular session, please.
आपने इसके नाम भी लिया अभिषेक
Those cultures are also lost. Most of the time, these cultures are lost. So, my humble submission would be that if you have any culture, you submit it in culture collection and let it be available for other people. If you have a very good culture, who knows it? Only you know it. Let other speakers also, you know, this will be a big contribution towards our nation. Thank you for submitting. Thank you very much.
Madam.
Thank you, sir.
It's a little bit.
So, this was the last lecture of technical session 3. This was the last lecture of technical session 3. Before we proceed to the last session, I would like to thank the chairman, the co-chairman, and the rapporteurs and all the speakers for their valuable and very insightful lectures. Now we'll proceed to farmer scientist entrepreneur interaction. We'll be just taking 5 minutes break and then we shall be joining again. Here I would like to tell that सबसे पहले हम farmers से बातचीत करेंगे जो किसान बागवान हमारे साथ इस पोर्टल पे जुड़े हैं. सबसे पहले हम उनसे बात करेंगे, उनके क्वेश्चंस लेंगे और उसके बाद डॉक्टर अभिषेक मणि त्रिपाठी प्रिंसिपल एग्रीकल्चर रिसर्चर फसल वो अपना लेक्चर देंगे. तो हम अब से 5 मिनट बाद मिलते हैं, उसके बाद हम ये नेक्स्ट सेशन स्टार्ट करेंगे. थैंक यू.
जनरेटर
इसलिए मैंने 5 मिनट
ठीक है जनरेटर पे ले रहे ना फिर सुबह तो बड़ी परेशानी होती है
सवेरे से
12-11
अभी जनरेटर पे
जनरेटर से बड़ी प्रॉब्लम है सर. सुबह बिना उससे किसी के पास है डालता कोई है
चलाजी
वो बंदा पहुंचे
पहुंचे सर सुबह
चलाजी
10 बजे लगे
और बंदा नाराज हो रहा था
शर्मा जी को
बोल देंगे चले
बंद कर दो ना
चलने दो.
अच्छा
ब्रेक अच्छा रिकॉर्डिंग तो
रिकॉर्डिंग लाइव चल रहा
है नहीं नहीं बंद कर
बंद
तो फिर तो क्या
वो चाइनीज.